Educating Our Children was drawn up by the Department of Education and Science, outlining four subjects for debate. They were the school curriculum, the assessment of standards, the education and training of teachers, and school and working life. All four topics are important and well worth discussion, but when it comes to educating our children, several people at the London conference felt that there was an equally, if not more important, subject missing from that great debate. Bernie Grant there from Haringey in London, claiming the subject, as he puts it, of race relations in schools is far too important to be left out of any great debate on education. But it's not a subject that we're leaving out of our series of programmes, and in a moment I'll be talking to our studio audience. Now, when I say children from ethnic minority families, what I mean by that is children from groups of people who have immigrated into the United Kingdom from places like Pakistan, the New Commonwealth, the West Indies, or India. And two out of five of these children are British-born. So, the problem confronting the education authorities is that far too many of these black and brown children are what's called underachieving. In other words, they're not doing as well at school as they could or they should. To discuss the reasons for this and the implications for all the rest of us, I have with me a studio audience of West Indians and Asians who represent the largest minority groups in the country. And we're going to start with the gentleman who was putting his arguments very forcefully at the beginning, Bernie Grant. Bernie, as you said, you're a school governor from Tottenham, but in that speech at the conference, you talked about a constant confrontation between the black youths and the teachers in the classrooms. Well, what's going on? Is it really an eternal punch-up?
Yeah, I think that it would be fair to say that in the majority of schools in Tottenham, there is a lot of aggravation between the black youth and the teachers. And if I may, I would like to highlight some of the problems that I find in the education service. I'd like to make three points. Firstly, on the question of experts, and the education service is inundated with experts. We have educational psychologists, special advisors, special teachers with special grants to look after the problem of West Indian children. Now, all these people make a very comfortable living off the fact that the West Indians are underachieving in schools. And it's not in their interest, I would say, that a speedy solution is found to the problem of West Indian children. And under these stringent economic conditions, they've got to justify their existence. So I would say it is definitely in the interest of certain sections of the education service to drag their feet. Because let's face it, if all West Indian students were to become model pupils overnight, a lot of people will be picking up their redundancy money at the end of the week.
I don't think anyone's suggesting that any student should become model pupils overnight. But Bernie, why do you think it is that, what are the causes for the underachievement, if you like, of West Indian kids?
Well, I think that there are several causes. I think, first of all, if we turn to the problem of teachers, I think that anyone who has any connections with schools would know that teachers, the normal run-of-the-mill teacher, has absolutely no chance in a classroom with a West Indian child. He has no chance because he is ill-trained. He gets 2 or 3 hours, possibly a week if he's lucky, in some teacher training establishments within the country. And this, of course, is no sort of training to handle a class, for instance, of 40% West Indians.
Well, that's one very interesting point. I'm sure we should be coming back to you later. But in the meantime, let's move across, because I want to talk now to a lady who is the vice chairwoman of the Lewisham Community Relations Council, Sybil Phoenix. Now, Sybil, what actual evidence is there that West Indian kids are, to use this terrible jargon word, underachieving, not doing as well as they should? What's the evidence for it?
I'm quite surprised that you would put such a question. What is the evidence? The evidence is in front of you. You can see the number of school leavers who are not capable of holding a job because they're ill-educated.
Yes, but why particularly are West Indian young people being ill-educated?
Because to begin with, the education service in this country refused to accept that the West Indian child was at a disadvantage coming into the English school. It was always taught that because they spoke English, that they need not extra tuition for the handicap they suffer coming into the English education system.
So the fact that they do speak English is not, in your view, enough?
No.
All right, well, let's go across to a man now, Eric Bolton, who's right in the middle here, who, in fact, is Her Majesty's Inspector with special responsibility and a national one, I think I'm right in saying, Eric, for multiracial education. Just how bad is this underachievement by both West Indian and, come to that, Asian children? And indeed, do all children from these ethnic minority groups underachieve to the same extent?
It's not possible to give very neat answers to that because we don't have separate figures for the attainment of different minority groups. But the general picture that emerges from surveys, circumstantial evidence, HMI reports, is that, very generally speaking, children of Asian origins seem to be doing as well and better in some cases than the norms would lead one to expect in the scientific subjects, mathematics. Quite a bit of concern, though, for those groups of children in the linguistically based subjects and the humanities, where they don't seem to do so well. With the West Indian community, the concerns really are very different. It seems that the circumstantial evidence suggests that West Indian children underachieve against norms for society as a whole, right across the system, at whatever point one looks at it, whether one is looking, as Sybil was saying, at employment levels, where they do particularly badly in comparison with other groups, or even much younger children at their linguistic development in reading, writing, etc.
If some of that can be put down to background, wouldn't it be arguable that kids from poor white homes do just as badly?
Well, this is one of the complicating factors, that any migrant community, for a part of its early existence in a new society at least, tends to merge with the long-term and chronic disadvantage which has always been in that community, for various economic reasons. Yet there are quite different factors affecting an immigrant group, particularly an immigrant group which is black, because the pressures of attitudes towards race, of their own feelings of identity or problems of identity, enter in and confuse straightforward issues.
Let's just leave it there for the moment, because I want to come across to Trevor Carter. Now, Trevor is the chairman of the Caribbean Teachers Association. Trevor, in that capacity, what changes would you like to see in the system?
In the first instance, I would like to establish that the basic problem in the underachievement of black kids in this society, I think, is a symptom of racism in this society. I would like to establish that. As far as changes in the society, in the educational system, I would suggest that we have to look at the curricula much more deeply than we have done in the past. Because if, as I said before, that we live in a racist society, therefore teachers, the curricula and other aspects of education tend to reflect that society. Therefore, we must have changes and we must look at teacher training again much more seriously.
Stay with the curriculum for a moment. How do you want it changed?
Well, we would like to see the curriculum reflecting the kind of society we live in. For example, if one is teaching in one of the inner city areas, which we probably will be talking about, a teacher, I feel, cannot really teach in that kind of situation without knowing the community in which he lives. So therefore, the curricula must reflect the community, the backgrounds of the various people who live in that community. In the sense that it would give respect not only to the kids who come from the various ethnic backgrounds, but it would make the people, the indigenous people and the indigenous kids, respect those children much more clearly.
Stay there for a moment, Trevor. Trevor, don't go away, because I want to talk to the gentleman who's sitting right next to you, is Alan Groves, who is in fact the Chief Education Officer for the London Borough of Haringey. Now, Trevor there has talked about changes in the curriculum and a new attitude from teachers. Do you think it is possible to change teachers' attitudes towards ethnic immigrant children?
If it isn't possible to do it, then it isn't possible to achieve anything.
Well, what are you doing in Haringey?
Well, attitudes are, you know, fundamental to it, attitudes and resources. What we're doing in Haringey at this very moment is to set up an ethnic minorities committee to advise the education committee, a committee which will consist of professionals from the ethnic minorities who are working in the borough, from whom the education committee wants opinions before it makes policy decisions. And we're also at the same time setting up a curriculum development team, particularly on problems of West Indian children in the curriculum. And this will be a team again of teachers drawn from the borough who will rewrite curriculum, who will go into schools, teach with teachers, deal with teachers, and try and deal with the whole breadth of the curriculum that Trevor's referred to, not just what's written in the books, but
now, obviously this is early days, but isn't all this going to cost money?
It is.
If it is going to cost money, what do you say to the people who say, well, that money should be going to other deprived areas?
Well, I have to say that we have very limited resources. Haringey is a very poor borough indeed, and we've got lots of other problems to deal with. I agree with what has been said about why the West Indian kid is underachieving in school. But I think there's something else that hasn't been said, and that is that during the last 10 years, and that's really what we're talking about, we in the inner cities have been suffering from an enormous general migration problem. 1,000 education families a year move through Haringey. We've been suffering from the greatest teacher shortage that we've ever had. And all these factors have come together, and those in greatest difficulty have suffered most.
Trevor, just before we end, as it were, this section on the problems specifically connected with West Indian children, what would you say to the critic who came along and said, look here, you've come across to this country, we agree it isn't your system, but it is after all ours, we live here, it's up to you to get on with it?
Oh, very simply, I would say that although we are talking about black kids in the educational system, our problems are those of working class kids' problems in the kinds of areas in which we live. And I think if we stress some sort of development in education in the schools in inner cities, we are talking actually for working class kids too.
Right, and at that point, let's move across to this side, because I now want to talk about the problems or the situation in which Asian children find themselves. Here is Rashida Noor Mohammed in the front row. Now, Rashida is a community relations officer with special responsibility for education in Birmingham. Rashida, a lot of people lump all immigrant problems together. Do, first of all, Asian children have problems? And if they do, are they the same problems that West Indian children have?
The answer is yes and no. It's true, as it's already been pointed out in this group, that Asian children's English requirements were recognized faster, for obvious reasons, than the English language needs of West Indian children.
Because they didn't speak English in the first place.
That's true. Mm. But what was done about it? Well, you know, I have a question about that. I think far more could be done. For instance, it's been pointed out in the introduction to this program that 40% of black children, and I use the blanket term black, are born in this country. Now, if they are of Asian parents, and let there be no doubt that they are British, black British, if they are of Asian parents, then they are likely to come from homes where English is not spoken. So that an Asian child who enters school at the age of 5, it is reckoned, is set back in his school career by about 2 years, a factor which he never catches up with.
All right, so there we are. There's the English problem. Let's go across now to Tuku Mukherjee, if I've pronounced it correctly. Now, Tuku teaches in Southall in a high school, but you're going on to train teachers, aren't you, Tuku, later on
this
year?
That's right.
What, then, does the Asian community actually want done? From what Rashida said, it would be easy to get the impression that all that's necessary is more English lessons. But what do you want to see happen in schools?
Well, frankly, first thing, what I've heard today and what I have read recently, I'm quite certain that in many ways the West Indian community is utterly and completely trapped in a situation where they can't go further, can't go ahead, and they can't go back.
Are you saying that the Asians can go further, go ahead?
Well, obviously, yes, because in Southall it has a traditional culture, and we have had that to fall back on when we have met rejection from the society. And so as I'm concerned, I certainly believe this, that one of the first that we need is the recognition in terms of our language. To me, a language is God in flesh.
Now, does that mean having ordinary academic subjects, I don't know, like maths, taught in Gujarati?
No, I don't mean that, no. I mean that when we talk about modern languages, you're talking about French and German. Well, when we talk about modern language in this country, the most recent language that's been introduced in this country is, for instance, Hindi, Punjabi, Gujarati. And Hindi is one of the languages that's been spoken by more people, except Chinese, in the whole world.
So you're saying that these languages should be taught to all the children in the schools, not just to the Asian?
No, it should be running parallel with the modern language department, not something that should be done outside in the community. It should be a part of school curriculum, for the simple reason that we do not want the same thing to happen to us as in fact what has happened to the West Indian community, unfortunately, sir.
All right, now let's talk to a headmaster, Mr. Arvon Jones, who is the headmaster of the Sydney Stringer Comprehensive School, which is in Coventry, and I think I'm right in saying, Mr. Jones, that you have about a 60% immigrant intake into your school. From what Rashida and Tuku have been saying, are these the right kind of lines? And if they are, do you do that sort of thing at your school?
Yes, I think it is the right kind of lines. I think it's very important to stress the language. But then that doesn't solve the problem, because the major problem is also one of parents as well. And that a child born in this country is really in a tremendous conflict between two opposing values. See, we can talk about in-service training, I think we can talk about curriculum, and they are important, but there's something more fundamental still. And without looking at the structure of the schools, then you're not going to help the immigrant child achieve the right standards. I think, for instance, you see, you must have a very imposing and strong homeschool link system, whereby the teacher is in the home talking about the British education system to the parents and listening to the complaints and the fears. I think you must have a school which is not streamed, so that you have certain races, perhaps in the D stream, regarded as failures from the age of 11. I think, thirdly, you cannot run a proper school in the inner city area if you have corporal punishment. I think discipline has got to come from different other factors.
But let's get back to some of the points that were made over here. Direct question, in your school, could I go there and learn Punjabi?
Yes.
I could?
Yes.
As a white chap?
Yes. If you opted to. I wouldn't force white children to learn Punjabi, but the opportunity is there for them, as it is for every child in the school.
Rashida, let me come back to you just for a moment. Isn't there a danger here that if the Asians, to use Arvon's phrase, go back to their cultural background, which we talked a lot about, that they're going to become even more alienated from the rest of society?
I don't think so at all. I don't think a person can be a fully developed human being who has developed all his potential. And that's what this British system of education is all about, developing the potential of an individual. And if that individual happens to be from an Indian Punjabi background, then it is their right to develop that personality. By doing so, they'll become better citizens. They'll recognize their own worth in this environment of this multicultural, multi-ethnic society.
All right, let's go back to our HMI, Eric Bolton in the middle there. Does this all sound sensible, what you've listened to, Eric? Lessons in Punjabi, this kind of thing? Or is this the wrong track?
No, I think it is the right track. I think this linguistic issue needs to be rather more refined, in the sense that there seem to be three clear strands to it. One is the one which has already been stressed, about a wider range of options to choose other languages in the secondary school, essentially. That's what we're talking about. But there is the issue about preschool experience, which the Bullock Report and many other documents, not about minority groups, stresses as being of vital importance to a child's first contact with school. And I think we've really got to sort out in precise detail what that means for these very large numbers of children born in Britain coming into our schools who have not spoken English until they arrived at the school.
Now, what does it mean?
Well, it means that in some way, in those areas, we have got to work out means by which the teachers and the education authority can recognise that the previous experience was in another language. In other words, they need to meet their other language in some sense in that school. It's difficult and it's tricky, but I think we've got to do it. We've got to devise ways of doing it.
And presumably, going on to the in-service training, you would be broadly in favour of more in-service training for teachers?
Indeed, yes.
And specifically
and
what?
And specific in-service training. Well, we need training for people who are working in areas where there are particular minority groups which would specifically relate to the kind of things Alan Groves was saying were happening in his area. We also need training for the generality of teachers. And this is the difficulty, because if we're going to really address the race problem, which we started this programme with, then it concerns all children in all our schools.
All right.
And that's
a
big problem.
Let's end with a politician, Joan Lester, member of the Labour Party's National Executive Committee, former junior minister in the Department of Education and Science. Do you broadly agree with what Eric said?
I think I broadly agree with what Eric has said. I'd like to add two or three other points, if I might. I think the preschool child and getting into the home with the mother of the Asian child is vitally important. I think there can't be anything worse for a young child than to have to learn a new language when coming to school for the first time before he can or she can begin to be educated. This is a terrible shock for the child, and the child is alienated from what is going on in the classroom. Now, the other points I'd like to add are these, that one of the problems about some West Indian youths that we are talking about now have part of their origin in the fact that these youngsters came to this country very late in their school life. And they came to an educational system which was much more permissive, although structured. They came from a Victorian background. And we haven't bridged the gap for their parents in understanding what is going on in our schools. And this has been part of the difficulty. And I think that has given rise to something else, that because many of these children did not achieve very well, many teachers and others often unconsciously assume that a black or a brown child will not do very well. And that assumption is often built in to the teacher without really recognising what they're doing because they've had past experiences. I think we've got to somehow attack that one as well.
All of which, if I may say so, sound like contributory factors to the broad conclusions that your recent NEC report drew, that the Department of Education and Science has failed you, I think you said, consistently to do the right thing at the right time. It hasn't had a policy. What policy ought it to have, and is there any chance of getting it?
Well, I think there is a chance of getting it because more and more people are recognising the deficiencies of what has happened in the past or what has not happened in the past. And I think there is a chance of getting it, but certainly I think all of us in this have got to shed some of the theories that perhaps we had before, and I think the one about language is a very, very important one indeed, that Britain has got to recognise and the British educational system has got to recognise that the language of the parents of the child has got to become a means of communication and one which gives them a degree of security. But this is not something we've reckoned with in the past.
But in shedding all these theories and our previous misconceptions, do you then want to put into practice things by legislation?
I don't think it's a question of enshrining things in legislation. Many of the things that we have done in the past in relation to the children of ethnic minorities were not enshrined in legislation. It was a question of trying to discover the best way of dealing with something. It isn't a question of legislating for this, although I think there are areas, we have strengthened certain areas of legislation in relation to race, but it is a question, as it has always been in education for everybody, of recognising where we've made mistakes and changing where we are going. The whole debate on education that we have just had, which is the background to this programme, was not so much talking about legislation, it was talking about practices in education and what had grown up as custom in education, and some of that I think we've got to shed.
But a lot of that great debate has been about other things, like falling standards, the relationship
Certainly.
Between school and work.
Yes.
Isn't this problem a very minor one in comparison with the vast range of fundamental educational questions, or is this just as fundamental?
I think it's just as fundamental, and it isn't a minor one for the 40% of children in this country who are experiencing the very thing we are speaking about. This is a problem common to a large number of children, and you will go a long way to find another problem as common to so many children. And this is the point, there are all sorts of problems in education relating to different groups in our schools. But this is a problem that affects a large number of children, and if not handled properly, will affect their children and future generations to come. This is why it's so important.
Right, the potential generation of this country.
And on that, what must be said and not left out of this programme on education is that the history books and books that are used in school must be rewritten.
All right.
The history must be rewritten to show that the black man has made a contribution to the development of society.
And let's leave it there.
And they'll be respected by both sides.
And let's leave it there. On the subject of rewriting history, I have to say that is the end of this particular programme. Join us next week for the last in our series, when I shall be putting some of these questions and some of the others that have arisen during the series to Shirley Williams and Norman St. John Stevens. Until then, goodbye.